Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Can I welcome members and the press and public to the 15th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2015. Can I first of all ask those present to ensure that their electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they don't affect the work of the committee. Can I draw your attention to agenda item number one, which is a decision on taking business in private. The question is that we take agenda items number 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private. Are we all agreed? Colleagues, can I draw your attention to agenda item number 2, major capital projects. I'd like to welcome our panel of witnesses, which is in connection with the Scottish Government's 2015 major capital projects progress update. Can I welcome Alyson Stafford, who's the Director General of Finance, Peter Reekie, who's the Deputy Chief Executive and Director of Investments, the Scottish Futures Trust, Andrew Watson, Deputy Director for Financial Strategy, and Sharon Fairweather, the Deputy Director of Finance Programme Management for the Scottish Government. I understand that Alyson Stafford would like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to discuss with the committee the latest six-month report on major capital projects. Very detailed questions may best be answered by individual project owners, so if there are any points of detail that go beyond the information we have with us today, my colleagues and I, of course, will take a note and seek to respond swiftly. When we last met on the 29th of April, members were understandably interested in the work underway by the Office of National Statistics, ONS, to classify a major non-profit distributing, MPD, road project signed since the introduction in September 2014 of the rather confusingly labelled 2010 European System of Accounts. The Scottish Parliament has been kept informed throughout by the Deputy First Minister, including through two IPQs and a substantive oral PQ, in February, July and September, respectively. But allow me to recap more recent events briefly. On the 31st of July 2015, the ONS published its decision to classify the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route project to the public sector. As there is no route of appeal, I corresponded with the ONS to seek clarification on a range of points raised by the Scottish Futures Trust on this project, and this engagement is continuing. In parallel, the Scottish Futures Trust has submitted proposals to the ONS on the hub model. Again, this engagement is continuing. As Chair of the Scottish Government's Infrastructure Investment Board, I'm passionate to ensure delivery of vital infrastructure in Scotland and share the concerns of project partners and stakeholders in local communities. So I continue to impress upon the Office of National Statistics the importance of the issues we have raised with them, while also recognising their congested overall work programme. Just to say, the classification by the ONS has no bearing on how the Scottish Government accounts for these projects in our statutory accounts. The classification does have a bearing on how the Scottish Government records its activities against its HM Treasury annual budget. Without a conclusive position from ONS, the budget discussions with HMT cannot be finalised. In the interim, the Scottish Futures Trust continues to engage closely with project partners to work through the implications with them. Meanwhile, the Scottish Government continues to see progress in its overall investment programme, and since my last written report to the committee, the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital and Royal Hospital for Children in South Glasgow, the Inverness College, the Inverness Campus, Borders Rail, Ellen Academy and Lairdsland Primary School have all been completed. So that concludes my short statement, and thank you.
Thank you for your statement. First of all ask you to elaborate on some of the issues, and I think you've touched on them, but some of the time delays and the costs associated with that in connection with the ESA 10 interpretation.
So in terms of the time delays and costs, I'd like to ask Peter Reekie to respond to that because he's close to the individual projects.
Thank you, yeah. We've said that across the NPD programme, all of the contracted projects are going ahead with no impact on cost or their delivery programme from the ONS issue. So that includes the AWPR project itself. In Hub, there are a number of projects that are now affected or more likely to be affected by this issue. And those list of 12 projects have been made public to the Parliament. They include the Lothian Health Centre Bundle, an Invercargill Care Home project, Kelso High School, New Battle High School, Baldragon Academy, Elgin High School, Dalbeattie Learning Centre, Barhead High School, Our Lady and St Patrick's High School, Air Academy, and now probably going to be affected given the timescales of responses and our discussions with ONS, Campbelltown and Oban High Schools, and the East Ayrshire Learning Campus. So those projects across the Hub programme are currently approaching a stage where they'd be ready to reach financial close, and we don't anticipate that they'll be able to do so over the coming weeks. You talked about the cost implications of that. Until we finalise the position with ONS and are in a position to move ahead with those projects and reach financial close, we're not yet able to say what the full cost implication, if any, of delays to those projects are. There'll be a range of different scenarios with either contractors that have prices held or contractors where the final project price may be subject to some inflation, given the state of the commercial negotiations on each of the projects that are affected or could be affected.
So can I ask, in terms of, you advise that you're not able to specify because of the nature of the contracts, but I take it though you'll be aware of the details of the contracts and you may have been able to quantify that?
So these contracts are contracts that are not yet signed, mm-hmm. and it depends on some of the contractors' prices for projects that have reached what we call their stage two, their fully costed submission in the Hub development process more recently. The contractor's price may still be valid by the time we are able to tell projects that they're able to move forward to financial close. Others that have been in this position for a little longer, for example, the Lothian Health Centre bundle, it's unlikely that the contractor's price that they put forward originally will still be valid because it'll have gone beyond its usually 3-month validity period. So we will then have to refresh the pricing with the contractor and going back to the market, because all of these have transparent subcontractor prices involved with them. So there could be there will be some process to go through with the contractors to refresh their pricing for those projects.
Ms. Scanlon.
You mentioned various projects and obviously representing constituencies, and my particular interest would be Elgin High School, and there are serious concerns there. Convener Alyson Stafford mentioned ONS July this year. I actually have a written answer from John Swinney, which is the 13th of February this year, which says that they are looking at contractual changes and et cetera to reach a conclusion and would keep Parliament informed. So I wouldn't like to mislead anyone and say that this has suddenly come out of the blue in the last 3 months. It has been known for some time. So, Convener, I just want to put that on the record. My first question is, you mentioned we've got today projects included within the pipeline for the first time. And you mentioned some, including Campbelltown. Are there other projects, including the ones we have on our page 60 and 61 today, quite a considerable list? Will any of these be affected, or is it just the ones that you mentioned, New Battle Abbey, Elgin, Baldragon, Kelso, NHS Lothian and Inverclyde?
So I'll ask Peter.
This is a worry for people that the Moray Council thought they were going ahead with Elgin High School, and they're under a lot of pressure, plus apparently the costs are rising by £100,000 a month, and they're really worried about who's going to pay.
I appreciate the point that's being raised, yeah. And given it's about a detailed project, again, Peter Reekie, because he is close to it, would be best to answer this.
Thank you, yeah. The ONS issues will only affect projects that are due to be revenue funded through either the Hub or MPD programmes. So they would be noted as design, build, finance and maintain, and have a flag against them as being revenue funded in the documentation. The majority of projects that have been recently added to the list are primary school projects that will be design and build projects, and they will not be affected by the ONS issues.
Okay. Can I just ask on that point? I mean, I did try reading and understanding this last night. I think I sort of got halfway there. But my understanding, for example, paragraph 20, there's not publicly, the government hasn't put a cost on delays, so I accept that. I also accept that the SFT has submitted proposals and the ONS are expected to respond next month. But my understanding is that the ONS reclassification depends on the amount of private sector involvement as opposed to public sector. And what I really want to ask is, we've had so many discussions on this committee about what is a PFI and what is an NPD, and I think it was Audit Scotland said the NPD was a form of private finance initiative. If it was the old PFI, would we not be facing this reclassification? Is there something to do with the way that NPD or a hubco projects are set up that is making this investment more tricky, more difficult, less able to fit in with ONS reclassification, and ultimately leading to delays?
So, Ms. Guy, if I start first and then I'll ask Peter to come in.
Understand
of
this.
Course.
It's not the easiest paper.
It's not, and you're not alone, actually. A number of people who are actually just trying to, who aren't having to specialise in it, having to just understand it. And I appreciate when you're trying to explain that to constituents, that's very difficult as well. Just around the, you've referred to a paper, which I think is private to you. So I'm unable to address any particular things that you've referred to in a paper there. Happy to look at it afterwards and come back if that's useful. I mean, the particular thing with the Office of National Statistics, it is actually a statistical body. And it's there ultimately to set out in statistical terms what's the size of the private economy in the UK and what's the size of the public economy in the UK. And it starts at very high level. The reason why the ONS is part of our considerations in relation to these projects is that they have published, or the Eurostat that they work to, have set out new standards for assessing projects. And those new standards actually came in very late in the day, in September 2014, and how that's why it's particularly nudging up against the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route that was signed in December, with the long lead times that they have. The Treasury have chosen to use the European standard as an indicator of a measure of how then they are asking Whitehall departments and devolved administrations to budget for these things. That only changed in 2009, when actually the accounting and the budgeting were absolutely aligned. And when the UK government changed to international financial reporting standards, they actually realised that that would sound the death knell to any kind of PFI, PPP, NPD project, because they actually were in, they're in conflict in many ways between the two. So they actually, at that point, it was all really straightforward in the scheme of things up until 2009. But when the accounting arrangements changed, the budgeting was out of kilter and all PFIs and PPPs wouldn't have continued at that point. So Treasury found another reference point for determining how we score activities against the actual Treasury budget. At that point, they said, right, we'll use this statistical indicator. And the reason why we're having to deal with looking at this now is because that statistical indicator has changed. It's changed materially, and it's changed at short notice, because when the interpretation document that was to help us understand what this new standard came out, that interpretation document came out in August 2013. That didn't give any particular cause for concern. The Treasury actually held a session for experts in the field, so Peter went along and others, in March 2014. Thank you. And that didn't show any particular cause for concern. It was only when then the Eurostat themselves revised their own interpretations in August 2014, as they published the standard in September 2014, that actually that started to signal that there were some material changes here. that actually then started to call into question the private classification, not only of the things that we've got well underway, and if you think of the lead time for building any road, you know, it's a long lead time, but also for things that the UK government were looking at as well. So the private finance initiative, Private Finance 2, actually was one that was under scrutiny very early on. So I think irrespective of the type of model that is being used to get, in effect, additionality over and above the usual capital programme, these latest changes have caused not only us in Scotland, but also the UK arm, the Infrastructure UK. I'm trying to remember all the names rather than the initials. Infrastructure UK have had to take a look and stop and pause again. And similarly in Europe, it's happening across the piece as well.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Just for my information, is it the invariable practice to form an SPV for any of these individual projects?
The very simple answer to that.
The record, can colleagues just refer to the acronym just so that we can you refer to it first and then
special we'll purpose it. Vehicles.
Just for the record though, just so that we're clear for it.
Yes. When a project is project financed, the financiers like to see a very tight ring fence around the money that they're putting into the project, and they're able to see exactly what risks they're exposed to and exactly what rewards they're going to get for taking that risk. And the way that in financial circles that's generally done is to set up a specific company whose only job is to do that one project. And the company is set up to do the project, and after the project is completed 25 years later, then the company will cease to exist. Those companies, because they only do one thing, that project, are known as special purpose companies or special purpose vehicles. And it is always the case that for these sort of projects, a company like that is set up.
Okay. Now, in the past, these SPVs have been wholly owned by Hubco, and they had the name of sub-hubcos. Somebody must have thought for that name. Sub-hubcos. Now you're changing that to design, build, finance and maintain, which is DBFM. And obviously that reduces the public sector interest in that company. What are the implications for that, cost-wise and also management and control-wise?
So, Peter.
Sorry. No problem at all. The previous structure, as you said, was for the project company that was set up for every design, build, finance and maintain project to be 100% owned by the hub company that was set up in each of the five hub territories to take forward the hub programme. The revised proposals are to set up separate, as you've said, DBFMCOs, we love our acronyms, design, build, finance, maintain companies, so a specific company for each project that will be owned 60% by the private sector development partner in the hub area, 20% by a charity and 20% by the public sector, with half of that being SFT and half of that being the public body that holds the contract. Within that overall structure, there will be no implication for the unitary charge, the cost that is paid for the project. And within the governance arrangements, we will still have a public sector director sitting on the board of that delivery company to bring good governance and accountability to the delivery side of the project and enhance the overall partnership arrangements over the long term.
This charity that's going to have 20% of the company, a newly formed private sector charity, can you give me a bit more information about that?
I can give you a bit more information about it, but the charity is being established currently, and in the lead on that are the five private sector development partners across the hub territories. It will have independent trustees, and it will have one trustee from those private sector development partners, and it will have one trustee from the Scottish Futures Trust. And that charity will be established to take these stakes in the design, build, finance, maintain companies, and then will have the ability to use its share of any of the returns from those investments to take forward charitable works associated with the types of facilities and types of programmes that Hub is there to deliver.
Now, will this charity be across Scotland or will it be localised?
The intention is that there will be one charity set up across Scotland, because some of the activities that it will be involved in and will be reasonably specialist in investing in these projects. But I believe, although I can't speak for the charity, because the charity will be set up and have independent trustees, that the way it's likely to work will be that it will act as a foundation and will fund other charities to do works in local areas rather than itself undertaking charitable activities.
Clearly my concern is that money that's raised through the local community should go back into the local community. And, you know, if it's a national charity, there's always the risk it gets siphoned off elsewhere on the basis perhaps of greater need. I would certainly think there's a lot of need in my constituency, and I'd like to see anything that comes up in that constituency, any earnings from that constituency, go back into it.
I think it's absolutely right to want to see local benefits from local projects. That's one of the things that Hub is there to deliver overall. Over the very long term, so the 25 years or so that the charity and the projects are set up for, I'm sure there will be distributions made to various causes across the country. But I can't say exactly which cause at which given point in time.
Now, I asked particularly about the possibility of any additional costs, for example, arising from the use of this new model. And in the document I've got here, it does mention about the possibility of increased cost of borrowing because of the new structure. So there is a cost to having to move to this structure, or potentially.
So slightly separately from the establishment of the new structure, one of the things that ONS have potentially got concerns about is public sector bodies making capital contributions to projects and paying for elements of the construction during the construction period or when the construction is completed, rather than as a charge over the life of the use of the asset. So it is likely that rather than public bodies making those contributions, typically that would be a local authority in a schools project, and they would be able to borrow from the Public Works Loan Board and make a contribution of capital. It's likely that that will have to be financed through the project and repaid over the life of the asset in the unitary charge. There could be a small increase in the cost of borrowing from that element of the structure, and if there is, then that element would be picked up as part of a sort of no better, no worse arrangement that's been come to with the local authorities, and any additional cost of financing would be picked up in the central contribution to those projects.
Doesn't sound like a great outcome. I mean, if we're paying extra for the borrowing, will this depend on what the ONS comes up with, or is this a done deal?
Nothing's a done deal at the minute in all of this. As Alyson said, we're awaiting feedback from the ONS.
So this is, if you like, speculation at this point, that if it goes one way or the other, then we will incur these extra costs?
All of this remains subject to discussions that are ongoing with the ONS. Yeah.
Can we be clear that's something maybe we should be following up on down the line?
Okay. I'm going to bring Stuart Millen in for a very brief supplementary, and then I'll bring in Conk here.
Thank you.
I might just add something, and then very happy to take the question. Obviously, Mr. Beattie is concerned about some of the changes that might happen and whether there are some marginal cost implications. They are likely to be marginal. And what will happen at some point in time will be weighing up the relative benefits of a marginal change to enable things to continue on the trajectory that they are. Or whether or not, and one of the key things that all this is about is that when the capital budget has been cut that's being used in Scotland in terms of the main grant, and we've seen a 25% reduction in real terms since 2011 up to the end of this year, then that has been the trigger as to why these sorts of initiatives, and they're not the only ones, of actually bringing additionality. So bringing additionality for Scotland as a whole, it's bringing additionality in local areas. So it will be weighing up those two issues, but clearly there has been a real drive to still keep this pipeline live and active. And we know it has a really, really material impact on the economy of Scotland. If you look at last year, around about one third of the whole of the economic growth performance in Scotland was attributed to infrastructure investment. And the vast majority of that is what was happening through the public domain, whether it was through our grant funding, whether it was through National Housing Trust, whether it's through local government's own investment, or through MPD and hub type initiatives. So all of these things are really material. So we have to weigh up the whole picture when we get to that.
Very briefly, and then
just to say that, can
we keep these changes as focused and as brief as possible, please?
Just to say that I appreciate what's been said there, but my concern is that we're talking about basically a bookkeeping change here, which is going to have a real cost on our projects, and I think that's unacceptable.
Okay, can we note that? And we'll take action on that. Is Stuart McMillan?
Thank you, Convener. It's regarding the creation of the charity. Will that be able to deal with the arm's length foundations, the ALFs? That it's something that we've actually had discussed before regarding the colleges, and it's something that we've actually highlighted in this committee in the past.
So, Peter.
This charity will be established explicitly for the hub programme and to deliver investments in hub projects and to deliver with those returns on investments charitable funding for similar sorts of activities. It's very separate from anything that's happened previously or you've discussed previously in the colleges sector.
But will there be an opportunity for the charity to maybe invest in the college sector and also through the arm's length foundations?
If I respond to that, and I think it's still too early to tell. Obviously, part of the development of the charity is still around getting the additionality through the hub programme. I think we would want to cross that hurdle first. And then obviously, we don't want to see any cluttered landscape at all in Scotland if there's any potential from that. Bearing in mind the charity will be something that will by its very nature, as Peter has already said, have to operate in a position that's more distant. So it would have to decide what its own arrangements were going to be. But I wouldn't rule anything out, but equally at this stage, I think one step at a time is the best advice to follow.
Okay. Yeah.
You've answered part of the question in one of your answers there, but it's just in relation to HUBCO, and in particular the Health Board partnerships. I have to admit that my interest in this is the North West Edinburgh Health Centre, which is due to be built at Muir House. And there's a degree of worry since this has kicked off. And obviously, in terms of we don't know what's going to happen with the exactly what the future funding is from what I'm gathering, but has there been any cost implications in terms of the work that's already been completed on these projects? Obviously there's a design aspect in the way that things move forward here. Is there anything that might end up a costing to these projects just because it's stalled and the initial work has begun?
Peter?
The development work done to date on all of these projects has been around the design development, the scoping of the project, the understanding of the requirements, and taking the design on that and the other projects to really quite a well-developed stage. None of that design development is wasted work. There's a full commitment to taking all of these projects forward once the issues have been resolved. So our anticipation, as I've said, is that given that that one has been in this state for a little while now, is that there will have to be a refresh of some of the construction costings, but then that will allow the project with its current design and its current scope on its current land that's been allocated to it to go ahead.
And has there been any problems caused to any of the other partners on the back of this?
I can't tell you the detail of every individual project and whether there has been cost to any of the partners involved. And to date, there will have been costs in relation to design, but that's work that's very much needed and will be important going forward for the project. Yeah.
Okay.
Just as one of the areas that we looked at and when you were here the last time was the issue regarding the two Seamal ferries, and also it was very recently Ferguson's and Port Glasgow were awarded the preferred bidder status. There seems to have been the final announcement has not yet happened, and certainly with the paperwork that we have in front of us, it's suggested that the final announcement was to take place by the middle of September. So I'm keen to have an update on the situation regarding that particular order, please.
Okay, I'd like to ask Sharon to respond.
My understanding is that they are very, very close to getting a final signing on that, that we expect that in the next few weeks. I haven't got the detail as to the delay to getting that signing, but I have no reason to believe that they won't be signed very shortly.
Were there any complaints from any other member states within the EU regarding the process that's potentially had an effect upon the fact that it's not been completed by the middle of September?
Not as far as I'm aware.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Can I, on behalf of the committee, thank the panel for their contribution this morning, and we can follow up via the clerks for any further information that may be required. Thank you. Could I just allow for a brief suspension for about a minute to allow the next witnesses to change over? Okay, good morning. I just reconvened to agenda item number 3, which is the Section 23 report, Accident and Emergency Performance Update. I'd like to welcome our panel of witnesses, Paul Gray, Director General of Health and Social Care and Chief Executive of NHS Scotland, John Connaghan, the NHS Scotland Chief Operating Officer, Catherine Calderwood, the Chief Medical Officer, and Alan Hunter, the NHS Scotland Performance Director of Scottish Government. I understand that Mr Gray would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I'm conscious of time and therefore will keep it brief. We have faced some very challenging times in relation to accident emergency performance, especially last winter, and I want to acknowledge that and the effect that has on patients and their families, and also the fact that staff through that have worked exceedingly hard. The key factors affecting performance last winter included unprecedented levels of activity, about which we can say more later if it helps the committee, and bed days lost as people awaited care in their communities, and therefore had delayed discharges. Scotland's unscheduled care performance last winter deteriorated, but it was in line with other parts of the UK and indeed on a similar basis to other similar health systems across the world. Our core A&E performance was about 1% better than England in winter 2014-15, whereas the previous winter it had been about 1% worse than England. We're not at the standard we're striving towards, I accept that. However, performance against the four-hour A&E target increased to 95% over July and August, from a starting position of 86.1% in the week ending 22nd February when we started publishing weekly. In the last 3 months, performance has reached 95% on 7 occasions and has been above 94% on a further 6 occasions during the same period. There has also been a significant reduction in long waits over 12 hours by 99% since January to the week ending 27th September. In order to ensure that we have a structured approach going into this winter, we've launched a new improvement approach to unscheduled care using 6 fundamental actions, and again we can speak to the committee about that if they'd find that helpful. And we've invested a total of about £55 million in this year to address issues affecting performance, particularly over winter. I can give a breakdown of that if the committee would find it helpful. That is significantly higher than the investment last winter, which was £29 million. We've also issued winter guidance to NHS boards 2 months earlier than normal. We are focusing on tackling unscheduled care from a whole system perspective. And I do want to assure the committee that we're well aware of the complexity of the issues affecting performance. We're working hard with our partners to deliver sustainable benefits to ensure that patients receive timely treatment and safe, person-centred and effective care. Happy to answer questions from the committee. And I will say that if we do not have information immediately to hand, we will provide it as quickly as we can in writing after the committee session closes. Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gray. Can I just open by referring you to your submission, but also you referred to the examples of key national programmes, unscheduled care. Now, noted in some of the bullet points, for example, it says here, senior clinicians and managers working together at site level to ensure accountability for performance. There's another example, it says, using the best available data to develop patient capacity and management plans which are regularly updated by site-based teams to ensure good flow and minimise delays. Now, I've not done this morning, but I'm sure if I Google search this, I could probably find similar reference to those terms in previous documents that have been provided by Health Board over the years. So they're pretty generic terms that have been used over a number of years. So why would this be any different from what's been done before? Or should it not have been happening anyway?
Well, I think your last point first, convener, I believe that there ought to be close working between managers and clinicians, and yes, if it's not been happening, it should have been happening, so absolutely agree with that point. I think what's different about this year is both the fact that we've started this process earlier and we are checking very thoroughly that boards are actually following through on this. Boards will be publishing their winter plans on their websites by the end of this month. We're 2 months ahead of the game. We've put in more money. And if you would like more detail on the direct engagement we've had with boards, Mr. Connaghan would be the best person to provide you with that. I will, however, give you my personal assurance that I've been engaging directly with chief executives and with senior clinicians through the chief medical officer to ensure that the importance that we attach to doing better this winter than we did last winter is clear.
So why wouldn't a manager and a clinician not have worked together before? I mean, you know, I can go back to the acute services review in Glasgow. I've seen reference to the exact same terms that I've met with senior officials at your level for the last 15 years. And every meeting I've had with them, they've said, yes, the clinicians and managers will be working together much closer to deliver these targets that they need to meet. So are you saying then that's not happened before and that should happen now? But what is there to say it's happening now?
So, for example, in NHS Lanarkshire, the committee may recall that there was a report published by Healthcare Improvement Scotland in December 2013, and one of the issues there was the capacity of clinicians and managers to work together because the governance structures were too complicated. So in NHS Lanarkshire, for example, there is now in each of the three main hospitals there a tripartite operation involving a senior administrator, a senior nurse and a senior doctor that wasn't there before. So it's there now. There's something there that wasn't there before. I can give, I and colleagues can give other examples from other hospitals if you wish. In each of the hospitals in Glasgow, there is now a formal identified site director. That was something that wasn't there before. So we have actually changed the system. We are not simply hoping that this will happen by the delivery of instructions or guidance. The system is different.
Okay. Ms. Gallon.
Can I just say, when I was on the Health Committee in 1999, we were actually asking managers and clinicians to talk to each other. And I have to say, given that I retired in a few months, I do find it quite sad that 17 years later, we're making a recommendation to say to managers and clinicians to work together. My first question is that it's about the increased demand, and I have a paper from Audit Scotland today, and it is very disappointing. Percentage of patients seen in A&E departments and minor injury units within 4 hours fell to 87% in January, the lowest since April 2008. But what I was hoping for today, Mr. Gray, was that we would get a better understanding of the increase in demand, because, you know, we all accept that. And what I haven't seen is that the increase in demand. I was hoping that you would address some of the issues. In Health Questions a couple of weeks ago, convener, 8 questions were on the shortage of GPs. Now, if you can't get a GP, we all know that. You go to accident and emergency. We haven't had serious winter pressures for many years. And a report out yesterday looked at the attendance rates in Ayrshire and Arran are twice as high as Tayside. And we also, in the same report, know that a number of attendants in the most deprived area is about more than 3 times the number in the least, twice as much as the least deprived. And I'd hoped, given all this time and all the pressures on A&E, and given the fact, convener, that the report came out in May 2014, we're actually discussing a report that's about 18 months old, I had hoped that the recommendations, instead of asking clinicians and managers to work together, I had hoped that it would be a little bit like more analytical, more forensic, and understanding why we have these pressures at A&E and what's being done about it. And from that point of view, well, I would like you to answer that, but I hope you don't share my disappointment without addressing these challenges that we all know are in the system.
Well, you made 2 important points, Ms. Scanlon. One is about the clinicians and managers working more closely together, and the other is about the demand on the system, and the Chief Medical Officer will be able to give you some details about both of these if that's acceptable to the committee.
I think on the point of clinicians and managers working together, I think it, as you rightly say, it sounds obvious, and what we have recognised is that in fact it doesn't seem to be something that happens automatically or happens just because it should. What we're introducing is much more formal education and learning, so paired learning of managers, trainee managers and clinicians actually as part of the education when they're in training, and also having groups of formal educators throughout the health boards in Scotland. So instead of just expecting it to happen, because you're right, it hasn't, we're actually formalising that process, and I think that we have examples now in every health board where different departments have taken on that. It's early stages, but it's something that we're progressing.
Clinicians and managers are being educated and trained to talk to each other.
It's about understanding each other's work within the system, I think. They do talk to each other, but it's more formal understanding.
You're asking them to work together. So they're being educated and trained in order to help to make them work together.
Absolutely. I'm speaking to the Institute.
That's sad in a country of 5 million people.
I suppose they work
together, but perhaps not as effectively as probably because of lack of understanding of each other's vital roles within the service.
Right, you haven't addressed the major issues, which is the sort of exponential increase in demand.
So we have a huge increase in our older population. We expect the number of people over 65 in Scotland to increase by 62% by 2035. We know that our numbers of people with comorbidities is also rising exponentially. So that would be someone who has diabetes and heart disease, has perhaps had a stroke, or is on long-term medication. And we, if I use diabetes as an example, in the last 20 years, our number of people with diabetes in Scotland has risen from 22,000 to 237,000. So more than a tenfold increase in that condition alone. Diabetes is a good example because, in fact, diabetes puts you at increased risk of cardiovascular disease, so heart attacks and strokes. It's also has neurological and eyesight issues and chronic kidney disease. So when we have a population who are... It's a success story because they're living longer. These comorbidities are part of this increased demand, and those increased demand on both elective services within hospitals and also emergency services.
You haven't addressed my question, which we all know that, the silver-haired brigade are living longer, and I'm grateful for that. But you haven't addressed the two issues that I raised, and that is that emergency departments' attendance rates in Ayrshire and Arran are twice as much as Tayside. Why is that? And why is it that people from poor, the most deprived backgrounds, the number of attendances is twice as high as those from the least deprived? I would have thought that if we understand that, only by understanding can we address this huge increase in demand. It can't all be older people.
So I suppose if I take the example of multiple comorbidities, we know that those are much more prevalent in our most deprived communities. And that's partly because of so-called lifestyle diseases of smoking and substance misuse. But it's also because that perhaps access has not been as good or as efficient as it could have been. So we definitely have propensity to the more deprived communities requiring emergency services, and if we look at areas where accident emergency departments, for example, Glasgow Royal Infirmary, that will be deprivation is causing a lot of that demand. Mr. Hunter might come in about the differences in Tayside.
Dundee is quite a poor city. Yes. There are very poor areas in Dundee, and it has the lowest emergency department attendance rates.
So you, Alan, I visited Tayside A&E department in August of this year. So, but Alan will talk you through the detail.
I mean, the attendance rates in Ayrshire and Arran are higher per head of population, as you say, and the reasons for that are varied across Scotland. I mean, part of it is the underlying morbidity within the community and deprivation, but it's also to do with the way the services have been profiled over the years. And in terms of Tayside, they have got redirection policies that we've now adopted, and through the programme that you've referred to earlier, we're promoting redirection and making sure that patients are signposted to the right locations. So in Tayside, they've been doing that for about 15 years. So in terms of other initiatives that are being promoted and also the benefits of it being shared across the various health systems are about, there's frailty models taking place that are services for elderly patients attending A&E. They're designed to actually get the support in place, quickly identify problems before we admit the patients, because if we admit elderly patients, it is better to keep them in their own community if at all possible, and only admit them. And so, for example, in Fife, they've identified that they've managed to avoid, on average, 20 elderly care admissions per week, and they're building that service up. these types of models are being shared across Scotland. So in Ayrshire and Arran, they're also putting a frailty model in. In Dumfries and Galloway, they've put in weekend discharge teams to actually try and get the weekend discharge rates to normal weekday rates. And these things are all designed to try and address the types of problems that Ms Scanlon has highlighted.
Thank you, Vera. Our discussions today are all over statistics and figures and comparing these figures. In the past, we've had considerable difficulty in collecting statistics in NHS. To what extent has that improved? To what extent are these figures accurate?
Well, the figures are reviewed before even the weekly publications are reviewed by statisticians to ensure that they are as accurate as they can be. The more long-term publications go through a more thorough system of checking and validation. So the figures you get weekly are management information, which is checked by statisticians for consistency. And the the monthly publications and quarterly publications go through more thorough checking. So I would say, Mr. Keir, that we take as many reasonable steps as we can to ensure that the figures are as accurate as they can be, and we also ensure through our statistician colleagues that the formal processes set out in relation to national statistics are followed for those that are published as national statistics.
I mean, clearly we're measuring ourselves against the notional figures we produce here in Scotland, or targets we produce here in Scotland. Do we benchmark as to how we're doing for overseas compared to the sister nations in the UK, for example, or Europe?
Yes, we do. We compare ourselves with the other nations in the United Kingdom, but also with nations with similar health systems in Europe and beyond. And if it was helpful to the committee, we can give a brief overview of that now, or provide in writing a more detailed overview. I'm happy, whatever suits the committee.
It would certainly be useful to see it.
Yeah, I think providing writing that would be helpful.
We can do that, Convener.
But we're looking at statistics, and statistics are a fairly dry thing. The important thing is the outcome for the patient. And how are we measuring that in terms of these statistics? How are we measuring what's actually coming out at the other end?
Well, I'll turn to the Chief Medical Officer on the clinical matters and to the Chief Operating Officer on any detail that's required. But since we're talking about A&E performance, there is good clinical evidence to support the value of a 95% target. So for some patients, it is not appropriate for them to be moved out of A&E within 4 hours. It is better for them to stay there, either to be discharged a bit later or to be treated in that place because they are acutely unwell and it would harm them to move them. But for most patients who present in A&E, there is good evidence that if they can then be moved, either discharged or moved on to another place of care and treatment, the outcomes will be better. That's why we strive to meet that standard. It's not a merely arbitrary decision. It is higher than some of the other countries on which we will provide the written evidence, but nonetheless, in consultation with the College of Emergency Medicine and other emergency department advice, that is the standard on which we have settled based on clinical evidence, because that, the evidence is that that is what produces the best outcomes. But the Chief Medical Officer will be able to say more.
So we have evidence that longer waits in A&E lead to increased both morbidity and mortality for a range of conditions. And so it's the point of definitive care that is important. If you need a specialist cardiologist, the quicker, the sooner that you can be not only seen and triaged in A&E, but then end up in a specialist ward because of the other facilities that are available on that unit.
Can I just add a couple of things to that, but maybe just also add a comment on management and clinicians working together. Previously in Glasgow, we had a matrix-style management, which is, let's say, one manager, one clinician managing the surgical service across a number of different sites. And that was fine, and it was very effective for planning purposes. This latest approach to managers and clinicians working better together is a question about who's in charge on a particular day for a particular site. And while matrix management is good for planning, it's not all that effective for taking quick and short decisions on what's going to happen this afternoon if there's an issue this morning. So that's one of the aspects that lies behind that recommendation. As regards measuring the impact on patients, we did issue guidance 6th of August 2015, which is the most comprehensive guidance we have ever issued in relation to winter planning. It has over 100 checklist items that we have asked boards to look at, including things like the effectiveness of cases presenting at A&D in terms of the respiratory service that we make available. And all boards will be reflecting that in their winter plan, which is due for publication at the end of this month, end of October. We already have these draft winter plans in from boards and are engaging on them, and that whole process is now 2 months earlier than it ever has been before. So we want to try and get ahead of winter, and we want to make sure that the measurement systems that we have are appropriate for patients.
So just before I bring Nigel Dorning, can I just come back to the point you raised there in connection with the clinician and management relationship, that, I mean, effectively, are we saying then that a clinician who's obviously got a responsibility to their patients, who's effectively in charge of them? Is it the manager who's in charge of the clinician, or is it the clinician that's in charge of the clinic?
It depends on how local management is set up. I have, as a chief executive in three different health boards, had both managers in charge of service as well as clinicians. Personally, I like to encourage clinicians to take charge of services. I ran a system where we had a clinical director in charge of each of the major components of the service provision in that health board. But it really depends on the nature of the task and who's best to do it.
So does that not then lie to some of the challenges that are faced in that respect then? Because effectively the consistency of the system is that nobody really knows who the manager is. It's different in each locality. But also the other issue is that the actual clinicians, there's some who are in charge and some who are not. Does that not lead to local issues as well?
Can I come in on that, Convener? Because it's a very fair point. So using the example of Glasgow, there is a rota of lead director to cover weekdays and weekends. And at some points the lead director will be an administrator, and at other points the lead director will be a clinician. I actually think that's a good thing, because effectively it means that the clinicians and the administrators are codependent on one another. To put it positively, if it's an administrator on a Friday and they leave a good, well-flowing system for the clinician on a Saturday, then that's beneficial. But if either of them leaves a bad product for the other, then that actually is not beneficial. So I think the system of rotation, it actually works well, because it means that everybody has to work in the interests of everyone else.
But can we be honest about this? So there are senior clinicians who really don't want to be managed, do they? Because they look at it from the perspective of they have a responsibility to their patient. That's their absolute priority. So that's a culture that's existed for a long time, and it's quite difficult to manage, is it not?
I would... I'm saying this with a smile on my face, Convener. I will not be drawn into criticising either administrators or clinicians, because the top ones in either profession are the ones who are committed to the delivery of a safe, person-centred and effective care. Yeah. Sorry, Convener, I apologise. I don't mean you were trying to get me to criticise, but...
But I think I'm just being realistic about the situation we find myself in. There are senior clinicians who have a responsibility to their patients. They don't always like to be put in a position where somebody's saying to them, well, you have to look at diverting your resources to somebody else. That's a clinical decision that sometimes you have to make. So they're not every clinician wants to be a manager, do they?
I'll take it, John. That's okay. The point is that by having them working together in the way that we do, we are fostering joint working in a way that we haven't before. And you're right, there are points at which an administrative decision about the availability of a bed and a clinical decision about the needs of the patient can come into conflict. Now we're having the conversations. It's not simply a battle where somebody from on high says, do this and it's done. The conversations are actually happening. That is why we're training them together. I'm very clear that getting people to work together and talk to one another is the way to resolve this. I can give any amount of instruction, the CMO can give any amount of instruction. The real thing that will work is when people work together. I totally accept your point about the potential conflict between administrative decisions and clinical decisions, but that's why we've got to get better at it. We can't just let it stay as a conflict.
Okay. Nigel Hunt.
Good morning, colleagues. I would like to pick up on a couple of things you've suggested. That winter pressures next year will be addressed, as I understand it, by getting guidance and instruction, dare I say it, out a little bit sooner, but also by putting some money in the appropriate places. I'm quite prepared to believe that you'll put that in the appropriate places. But money buys you people. That buys you, in this context, professional people. Given that we all know as MSPs that it's difficult to get the right people, and maybe there aren't spare people hanging on skyhooks, how is that money actually going to buy you more medical resource in the winter months when we're more likely to suffer from flus or whatever, and we're far more likely to fall over in the street and have a broken wrist?
So, 30 million of the money that I've mentioned is to address delayed discharge, which is not actually requiring us by and large to buy hospital-based services, but rather to support the integrated joint boards and the delivery of services that are out of the hospital. The CMO will be able to tell us how that money might effectively be deployed in more detail, as will my colleagues. But we've put 9 million into unscheduled care. So again, what we're trying to do is to stop the flow in rather than deal with it once it gets there. And again, we're seeking, and points have been made quite validly about primary care. We're working very hard to strengthen the resource and development in primary care. So, in fact, the amount of money that's going straight into hospitals, if I may put it as crudely as that, is not a big proportion of what we've got here. But, CMO, you want to say something about the availability of staff and how that's addressed over the winter?
So the A&E departments who are expecting increased flow, and they do this throughout the year because of times of festivals or public holidays and obviously New Year's Eve, there are always a group of doctors, I'll talk about doctors initially, who would be available to do extra shifts. So they're locum shifts, but they're usually people who are working within the department. So that is something that is built in at times of expected high pressure. And that can actually be sustained for a number of days and weeks if there was particular cold weather, for example. Similarly, nursing staff, agency stroke bank staff, again, the boards are planning to have people available on the books, and if there weren't people available on the books, they would look elsewhere. So that's part of a planning structure. It sounds a little bit, you're talking about people hanging on skyhooks. They aren't, but they are to an extent, because there's availability of hours for them to work.
Right, thank you. I think that the helpful part of that, sorry, that was all helpful, but I think the interesting bit is to know that you're putting the money in trying to get people not to come in the first place and getting them out the other end, which does make sense, because obviously your constraint is the limited resource in the middle. Can I then ask about the other side of statistics? You've spoken already about the 95% discharge or moving on. Could I first of all encourage you to find a better way of describing this? I listen to people telling me that people haven't been seen within 4 hours. I know perfectly well from my own experience, just saw them almost immediately. The triage is more or less instant unless there is a queue, which is rare. It's actually getting folk moved on, which is the 4 hour. Could I encourage you to find words that describe that better, because the press don't understand it and therefore the public don't understand it. But you've said that 95% makes clinical sense. Could I ask you about what I suspect might be an increasing trend, that there are folk who come in who clearly you can triage, you can try and do some medical things with, but because they're under the influence of drugs and alcohol, you couldn't conceivably be moving them on in the 4 hours because you just can't finish the process. Do you have any statistical understanding of what fraction of those who present are in that category? Is it variable in different places? I suspect there must be some variation. Is that an aspect of the statistics which you ought to be presenting to us? Because if it's significant, then there's no way you can get to your 95.
I can answer some of that. If we split the population that present to emergency departments into two age groups, 0 to 64 and 64 plus, the 0 to 64 presenters in that age group, by far the biggest single cause of presentation is through poisonings. That's how it's coded, but poisonings really means perhaps overindulgence in alcohol, drugs, etc. The next biggest cause is chest pain. In the post 64-year age band, it's chest pain, respiratory failure, etc. thereafter. So it's basically a slightly younger age group that present, and it is significant. It is the biggest. But when we further analyse that figure in terms of presentation through poisonings, most of those presentations are in and out and dealt with within about a day. They don't tend to stay all that long in hospital, so they stay in the front end of the hospital and I think probably under observation until they can go home.
Right, that's helpful in the medical sense, but I am of course concerned about this statistic, and I'm sure you're concerned about the statistic because it's the one people keep bashing you over the head with. Is it fair to say that those who come in with what we will now politically describe as poisoning are less likely to be moved on within that 4 hours? Or am I actually up the wrong tree here? Are they as easy to deal with as everybody else?
We can give you the statistics and we'll get those. Splitting out the exact, whether it's somebody with an alcohol presentation that also has a serious problem that needs to be dealt with, clearly, there's big differences there. In terms of the performance, I don't think it is the biggest issue. Part of it is around how we get patients into the hospital, how we get the flow. So in terms of this year, we've over the summer, our performance has been around the 95%. We've managed to get the 95% of the patients through over the last 2 months. Clearly, building the resilience of the hospitals over winter is critical, and that's why we've been building up the work that we've been doing with the boards on winter planning earlier.
Okay, thanks again. We'll need to move on. Is that okay?
I was going to ask the CMO to answer the point in principle that Mr. Dawn was making about what types of patient is it not appropriate to move out of A&E within 4 hours, because I think that's the core of the point that was being asked, so it might be helpful to the committee.
I think you're concerned that we will never get to 100% because it's not appropriate. So there's a round about a 2% of patients who will not be able to be moved on within the 4 hours. Now, they may be because they're very significantly injured. It would often be something like major trauma. And so they will need a lot of many hours of working up, if you like, until they're stable enough to be moved on. There would then be a smaller number of people who would be deemed the poisonings is the way it's coded, but let's call it alcohol, would be thought to be able to be fit within, again, a period of time slightly longer than 4 hours, but not needing to be admitted. But then anyone else who would not recover well enough would then be admitted to a short stay or an observation type ward, where the expectation would be that they might be discharged within less than a day or won't need an overnight stay. But that figure in total is 2%.
Sandra White.
About data, it seems to be so important, and obviously everyone else has mentioned the gathering of data, but obviously if it's more broken down, and I'm certainly following on from Nigel Dawn's theme, I mean, this year, 2015, you know, basically I think it was very good recording, just under 96% of patients across Scotland were seen within 4 hours. But I wonder, when you're talking about waiting times over 4 hours, etc., do they ask, when patients present at A&E, do they ask some questions such as, why did you come to A&E? Couldn't you get a doctor's appointment in time? Bank holidays when doctors are closed. Are these questions asked when people present at A&E? Because certainly I know I get that feedback from constituents that they couldn't get a doctor's appointment, so they just went to A&E. You know, the doctor was shut in the bank holidays, so I went to A&E. Do you gather those statistics as well?
And I think that there's a recognition that that the other parts of the service need to be engaged with more. There's a campaign called Knowing Where to Go, run very effectively with the new hospital build in Glasgow, and signposting people to NHS 24, to their what the opening hours of the local GP's surgeries were, to minor injury units, which may of course be geographically closer as well as more appropriate. More longer term, Tayside have actually got an extremely good education for the local population with then their attendances at A&E are actually extremely low proportionally compared to the people who've been sent by their GP. So it seems to work very well once the, and it's partly education, because I think people aren't necessarily aware of what is available, the times of availability, and again we are also encouraging increased pharmacy input. People can go to their pharmacist, and we're investing in fact in an extra 140 pharmacists to be placed alongside GPs in GP practices to partly, it's appropriate because of medicines management, but it's also to help the throughput in the GP practices.
Take on board what you say, and I read your report about Tayside, and certainly in my area on a couple of occasions when the GP surgery is closed, the pharmacy next door to them is closed also. So that's a bit of a concern, certainly at the September weekend. I certainly noticed that as well. But what we're seeing is you're gathering data, but you don't gather data about that. It's about education. And another issue that I wanted to raise in regards to data, yes, good, you know, just under 96% throughout Scotland, but four hospitals, and in particular Glasgow Royal Infirmary, two from Glasgow, Glasgow Royal Infirmary and Gap Naval in the Western Infirmary, were the two of the worst performing for over 4 hours. And picking up on Nigel Dawn's question about people presenting themselves, if someone is in a state of inebriation, you may say, it may take more than 4 hours to actually be able to treat or see them. So if we're looking at data, surely we should have that data there also. And is there any reason why? We've no statistic to tell us why these four hospitals, which is Royal Alexander and Paisley, Wishaw General and Royal Infirmary and the Western and Gap Naval, there's no data to say why they're the worst performing. No reasons why. We don't have any information in that.
One of the things that we're keen to do is to make sure that each board has its own hospital site plan, which is why having good site management is also important. We have spent quite a bit of time setting up not just a statistical gathering exercise, but also a process where we can roll out improvements. And in order to be able to roll out improvements, you really have to know what's the target that you're trying to aim for in terms of what you're trying to improve. So we know that there is variability across some of our hospital sites in terms of the ability to discharge patients before noon. We know that there is some variability across our hospital sites in terms of turning around beds within an appropriate time. So if somebody leaves one, do you have the appropriate response from domestic services to make sure that that bed is turned around and available? And that's particularly important for those sites that have got, let's say, single rooms. Okay. So we do have a fair idea. Indeed, the guidance that I've referred to earlier, 6th of August 2015, is the most comprehensive that we've ever issued. It has well over 100 different reference points for boards to look at to try and address those site differences. So, in summary, it's a mix of improvement as well as statistical analysis.
Just one tiny follow-up. Thank you, Karina. I think we also should, you know, when you're presenting the data in the various hospitals, and I know Mary Scanlon mentioned Dundee and, you know, basically the deprivation in some areas there, I think we have to be quite clear when you look at the hospitals like Glasgow Royal Infirmary, it's not just a local hospital, it's a national hospital, similar to York Hill Children's Hospital would be a national hospital too. Do you look into that when you're producing the data? I mean, it's not just people presenting. There's other areas within that hospital that, for clinicians and doctors, there may be a lot of pressure there.
I think that's a very fair point, convener. I mentioned a lot of things inside hospital. Of course, there's a lot of things that we need to do that are outside hospital. For instance, seven-day services, having staff available both in the community and in the hospital side to make sure that discharges are just as effective at the weekends as they are during the day is important. Understanding what we need to do in terms of having appropriate demand and capacity planning for each site is also important, because things change, patterns of attendance change. And I think, I can't remember which colleague mentioned it earlier, but over the past 12 years or so, we've seen a significant increase in the over 60 population in Scotland, about 200,000 of an increase. That brings its own demands in terms of extra requirements for both hospital and community-based services. So understanding how all of that fits together is important, and that's why we emphasise whole system planning.
Just mentioned something about Glasgow Royal Infirmary. So they introduced an assessment area a number of years ago, and they've now expanded that over the last a month ago, to actually include surgical GP referred patients. So they're adapting their services and their models to actually try and address some of the problems. And in Ayrshire and Arran, they're investing £34 million, I think it is, I'll confirm that figure, in realigning the front door services. So they're creating GP assessment areas, so adjacent to the A&E departments, and those developments are happening as we speak. The one in Ayr will be opening in January, and the one in Crosshouse will be opening in the summer next year. So things do need to evolve, because some of the buildings are older than others, and they need to adapt and move services, shape services to the best of the ability they can at the moment.
Thank you, convener.
Ms Calderwood, you mentioned the campaign, the Nowhere to Go, in Glasgow. Is that going to be rolled out across the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde area?
As far as I know, it was partly because of the new hospital, so it did spread widely to the areas of the other hospitals which were changing their services. I'm afraid I don't know about wider into Clyde.
Yeah, Alan. Nationally, there's a Know Who to Turn To campaign that will be launched in the end of November. And there's radio and various media opportunities. So that's part of the winter plan. It sits in with the redirection and signposting plans in each of the boards. So there is a national programme, and there's also local events to actually tie into that.
Okay, when I heard you talk about it earlier, I thought, well, obviously I represent the West of Scotland area, and I'd never heard of this. And so I'm glad that this work is going to take place on it. Now, is that just purely going to be focused upon the winter period, or is it to be something for post the winter period?
I mean, this is focused mainly on the winter period, the one in November, but there is recognition that we need to take that forward. So the guidance on redirection or signposting is getting rolled out. A number of boards are doing it. It's not just Tayside now. Fife are doing it. Grampian are doing it. Most boards are doing it, and most hospitals are doing it to a degree, but they build up confidence, they build up the staff's confidence now to do it. And Tayside, it's taken them about 15 years, but they've now got evidence that the local population understand and know if they go to the hospital, and it's really something that they can go to their GP the next day or their pharmacist, they're going to get told that they need to go to their pharmacist or GP the next day. So that helps. So those types of processes we've agreed with the Royal College of Emergency Medicine. The six essential actions that has site management and planning, and we're all agreed with the Academy of Royal Colleges, so the collective academy. So we've got clinical engagement in this at the top level and at local level, because we've now got lead consultants in each of the sites looking at these issues. So we are actually building up a process that is gathering momentum, and it's and it's the right way to do it, because if you know, short, sharp, short doesn't always work. This is a programme of change.
Certainly, using the Tayside example, I would imagine, obviously, I mean, they have collected a huge amount of data over the course of that period of time, and no doubt they will have estimated as to how many people they have managed to prevent from presenting themselves to the A&E in that particular health code area. And so I'm keen to understand a bit more in terms of the what the estimated figures will be for the other health code areas.
The estimated figures internationally around this are somewhere between 10 and 15% of patients can be dealt with elsewhere. You need to make sure that the links with the community services are in place, and that's what we're doing, and there are a range of initiatives there. So in answer to your question, yes, between about 10 and 15% of patients.
Okay, that certainly would be very helpful. Okay, one other area that, that was touched upon, and I actually hadn't thought of this really in terms of presenting to the A&E, and it was the use of the word festivals, and also there has been an increasing number of festivals, and with the whole tourism sector that we have in Scotland, it's a huge part of our economy, and more people come to Scotland on an annual basis. So in terms of the numbers of people who present themselves as a consequence of maybe having an accident or the poisonings, festivals, how important a part are festivals in terms of the numbers of people actually present themselves to the A&Es?
Yeah, I mean, boards plan on the basis of known events. They might be festivals, they might be football matches. So they plan on the basis of these known events to staff up effectively, because it is a fact that at certain events you are more likely to get A&E presentations. I'll turn to the CMO in a second. But to be honest with the committee, I'm less worried about festivals than I am about some other types of event, which do tend, I'm afraid, to produce regular throughput of seriously injured people. Alcohol playing a part, but also quite serious physical injuries at times, some arising from violence. The spread out of domestic violence around certain events is a big issue, which our colleagues in the police and fire and rescue services are working very, very constructively. The Violence Reduction Unit, for example, in Glasgow, another major contributor to that. But certain events do produce higher throughput, it is a fact.
And the planning is very detailed. I've visited NHS 24, and the Scottish Ambulance Service has it's a call centre type software, so that they at any time will have differing staffing for shifts, and of course a major event like a football match or prolonged something like the Edinburgh Festival over a month, that the manpower, the ambulance availability is mapped on a they're done in 15-minute slots, 24 hours a day, and the emergency departments are also similarly staffed with local events in mind.
Okay. Can I just ask a brief final question? In terms of, I mean, people do present themselves to A&E, as we said earlier, because phone the GP, and GP says it's going to be 3 weeks before you can get an appointment. So what do we tell people then when they arrive at the A&E, when they can't wait 3 weeks? What's the position then?
I'll turn to the CMO in a second, but I mean, one of the things about the NHS in Scotland is, if someone presents with something that can reasonably be treated at the place where they present, we will do our best to do that. We will not. So there is a redirection policy, but the point is, in Tayside, as has been said, they've been at it for 15 years, and they've got the infrastructure around that means that you can redirect people to something that is available. What we do not do at any point is that if someone is in need of help, some clinical intervention, we don't refuse it just on the grounds that they ought to have been somewhere else.
Okay. So, glad to know.
Yeah. And the growth in minor injury units is an example of that.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to thank the panel for the contribution this morning on behalf of the committee. And if there's any follow-up, we can arrange that via the clerk. Can I suspend the committee for 5 minutes? Okay. Can we move on to agenda item number four, which is evidence from the AGS report, efficiency of prosecuting criminal cases through the criminal the Sheriff Courts. Can I welcome our panel of witnesses? Can I welcome Caroline Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Angela Cullen, the Assistant Director, and Mark Roberts, the Senior Manager of Audit Scotland. Understand that Caroline Gardner has a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. On average, 88,000 people appear in criminal cases in Scotland's Sheriff Courts every year, and many thousands more interact with the Sheriff Court system as victims, witnesses, jurors, lawyers, and members of the judiciary. It's important for all these people and for society more widely that the Sheriff Court system works efficiently and effectively. Our report finds that there's mounting pressure on the Sheriff Court system. This pressure is coming from two main sources: financial pressures and the nature of the cases that are entering the Sheriff Court system. As with many parts of the public sector, budgets have fallen. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and the Scottish Court Service both saw their total budgets and their operating budgets fall by proportionately more than the overall Scottish budget over the period from 2010-11 to 2014-15. The nature of cases being considered by the Sheriff Court system is also changing. There are more cases involving domestic abuse and historical sexual abuse. This is a good thing. It means that the focus on these crimes by the Scottish Government and all the organisations involved is having an effect, and it's giving more victims the confidence to come forward. It also adds to the pressures on the system. These cases may date back over many years, and victims and witnesses may need additional support and time to allow them to give evidence. In terms of the overall performance of the system, one key measure is publicly reported: the percentage of cases that are completed within 26 weeks. In 2010-11, 73% of cases were completed within 26 weeks. In 2014-15, that had fallen to 65%. The data we present in the report, in Exhibit 8 on page 26, show that there's marked variability in performance against this measure across the six sheriffdoms. And we also report that there can be marked variation within an individual sheriffdom, as we highlight in Case Study 3 on page 28. A range of factors affect how individual courts function. These include the mix of types of cases being considered, the preparedness of procurators fiscal, the culture and behaviour of defence agents and the accused, and the way that sheriff's principal and sheriffs manage their courts. Inefficiency in the system is known as churn. Churn isn't always a bad thing, although it does cause an immediate delay. It might, for example, allow a case to be concluded earlier in overall terms. But in many cases, court appearances do not proceed as planned due to problems with the correct citation and availability of witnesses, the readiness of the prosecution and the defence, or the availability of court time. Based on our costing model of court appearances, we estimate that churn that should have been avoidable cost about £10 million in 2014-15. One fundamental challenge is that this is a system made up of individual organisations who have to operate independently for good reasons, but to improve its overall performance and efficiency, the system has to be managed collectively. We found that the establishment of the Justice Board by the Scottish Government in 2012 brought together the chief executives of the various public sector bodies in the justice sector and has improved joint working at a national level. We'd now like to see that replicated at a local level where joint working has been less successful. We've also made four detailed recommendations which aim to improve the management and performance of the Sheriff Court system as an integrated system and public reporting of the performance of the Sheriff Courts. Convener, as ever, we're happy to answer the committee's questions.
Okay. Okay, thank Caroline Gardner for her contribution. Can I just open by referring to the fact that you stated in your opening statement, and that was in connection with how sheriffs manage the courts. And can we be realistic about the challenge that we face here? Effectively, sheriffs are there to ensure that justice is carried out properly through the judicial process. It's quite difficult for sheriffs at the same time then to consider the costs associated with that if they have to ensure that there's a fair system that's implemented properly. Is there any examples of where possibly that could be improved without compromising the judiciary or the judicial system?
Thank you. I think we've got some very good examples, and I'll ask Mark to highlight a couple for you in a moment. It's worth being clear, though, that we're not asking sheriffs just to focus on the costs of the system. The costs are actually quite a good indicator of its overall efficiency and in how good it is at delivering justice as quickly as possible for everyone affected, not just the accused, but victims, witnesses and others. So we think there is a real public interest in making sure that the system works as well as it can do. Mark, can you give us some examples of where sheriffs and sheriff's principal have had that impact on their courts?
We highlight in the report in one of the case studies, page 36, kind of the extensive court management which goes on within Aberdeen Sheriff Court. And there has been kind of sheriffs working together in small groups and focusing on specific areas of legal activity, whether it's summary or solemn business. And that has helped in terms of earlier resolution of cases within Aberdeen Sheriff Court. And that's been a very active approach by the sheriffs within that court to try and improve the process of managing business through the court. That is of course, entirely separate from kind of the legal considerations that sheriffs have to take into consideration, which is as important. So.
And obviously, the other challenges that are faced is in terms of the availability of witnesses, which I know from constituents' experiences can vary from police officers retiring and perhaps being abroad and difficult to locate to other witnesses that are difficult to contact. So again, what can be done to improve that? Because if someone's clearly making it difficult to make themselves available, even though there is a legal process to deal with that, it can be quite difficult to improve that, is it not?
You're absolutely right that everybody involved in the court system doesn't have the same interest in making it work smoothly for obvious reasons. And we're not saying that there's a magic wand that can take away the problems at a stroke. Equally, I think we have found some examples where practical ways of working can help to improve the planning and the management of cases. Mark, do you want to pick up a couple of those?
Again, just to highlight one of the examples we quote in the report, under the Making Justice Work programme, there's been initiatives by Police Scotland, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and Scottish Court Service in trying to find innovative ways to remind people they've been cited for witness appearances, whether that's by text message or by having a record of mobile phone numbers and things. You mentioned the importance of police witnesses being able to attend court appearances. There's now a court witness standby system being instigated, which makes sure that police officers are called at the specific time when they're required in the court, rather than, as sometimes can be the case, that they're kind of required to be present all day just in case they're going to be called at a certain time. It allows a bit more precision as to when their appearance is going to be. And that has assisted the amount of police time that there has been waiting to be called to act as a witness.
Combity.
Thank you, Convener. In the report, page 7, paragraph 5, you state that you haven't included the court closures, which are obviously an ongoing thing at the moment. Presumably, you'll be coming back at some point to cover that, because it will affect the dynamics of costs and so on. So a lot of the costs that we're talking about here may not be absolutely relevant in the year or two down the line.
Yeah, the reason why we haven't explicitly looked at the court closures here is mainly a timing one. The report focuses on the period finishing in 2014-15, and most of the court closures were scheduled to happen during that year. We have looked at the data as far as it is available, and actually it's fair to say there's not clear evidence of an impact of the court closures on the efficiency issues that we're looking at here, partly because most of the courts affected were dealing with quite small numbers of cases, and you can see that in the data we present. We absolutely recognise that local courts are important to local people, but in terms of the impact on the efficiency of the court system, so far there's not evidence of a direct link there. We know that the Crown Office and Tribunal Service, the Courts and Tribunal Service, is looking at conducting its own evaluation of the impact of closures. What we're planning to do is to look at that evaluation and then see whether there is further work that would add value on the back of that at this stage. So we're keeping an eye on it, but timing meant it's not a key part of the report you've got in front of you.
It's clear the number of cases are relatively small, but I think the overheads might be disproportionately high. And my question really was, are you going to come back down the line and do a fresh analysis of all this, or a fresh report?
I think the answer is that we'll look at the Courts and Tribunal Service evaluation and look at the data ourselves and see whether there would be value in doing that.
Okay. Now, there's some significant percentages in here. On page 25, paragraph 39, it states here that the criminal justice targets are actually being exceeded, which is quite interesting. The pressure seems to be coming from the summary cases, where on page 12, paragraph 13, you're stating there's a 25% increase in justice to the peace courts. The volume of cases going through there, mainly because of road traffic offences, which is a motorist, is obviously a concern to me. Would you agree that it seems to be the summary cases rather than the criminal cases that the primary pressure is coming from?
I'll ask Mark to pick up the specific figures in a moment because he's absolutely on top of them. But I think your point is recognising one of the messages we want to get across here, which is the sheriff court system has to be managed as a system. Decisions that you take in one part of the system, whether it's the Police Scotland or the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, have an impact through, and you need to understand those to be able to make sure the flow works smoothly. Mark, can you pick up the specific factors that are driving change in there?
Just go back to the point relating to paragraph 39, where we talk about kind of the exceeding the targets. The Police Scotland have 28 days to submit a prosecution report after someone's been charged. Following that, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service have another 28 days in which to decide what to do with that particular case, and they both have targets for what proportion of cases meet those timescales, and as you say, both of those are being exceeded. Performance against those measures has dropped over the period that we were looking at, and I guess the consequence of that is that that puts more pressure on the court service, or now the Court and Tribunal Service, which does have the ultimate end stop of the 26-week overall target to meet. So more cases that take slightly longer to go through those two initial stages build slightly more pressure on the Court and Tribunal Service at the end. I think your second point was about kind of the impact of business going through JP courts, and as the Auditor General said, because this is very much a system, if there's a big increase in business in JP courts, that occupies courtroom time and courtroom availability, and that puts the squeeze on availability of courtrooms for summary and solemn business within the sheriff courts, because in some cases, as we highlight in the Exhibit 1 with a map in the report, there are an awful lot of court buildings which are used for both JP and sheriff courts.
I think the key thing I'm trying to get out of this is that if the criminal cases are being dealt with reasonably expeditiously, then clearly, you know, the bad guys are not getting the benefit of an inefficient system. It's the summary cases that are forming the bulk of the problem here. I mean, we see here statistics like sex crimes are up 80%, or at least the detection reporting of sex crimes are up 80%. We're seeing that domestic abuse cases entering the systems may well be taking longer to process. And this is all important because presumably they all lead through into the criminal side. So if they're managing to contain that, and if they're managing to actually exceed the targets, then I would have thought that side's doing okay.
It's the pressure is coming from kind of the overall 26-week target. It is a combined measure of the work of Police Scotland, of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Where there's more cases coming through on the JP courts, that adds to the pressure within the criminal side in terms of summary and solemn business, as it's occupying kind of available court time for doing other JP work.
I think from an audit point of view, it's important that we understand where the pressure's coming from. And if it's coming from the summary cases, obviously that it's a concern, but we need to try and understand what it is, what it means, and what the knock-on effect is. One interesting thing was the Auditor General said that courts had to work separately for understandable reasons, or these cases had to be handled separately. There is on page 35, paragraph 58, the final couple of sentences. Existing legislation means if an individual is prosecuted in the sheriff courts for two different crimes in two different sheriffdoms, these cases can't be combined. And there seems to be some indication here that there's some thousands impacted by that. Now, on the one hand, if I got it right, the Auditor General was saying that you couldn't combine these because they had to work separately, but maybe they should find a way.
Not quite. The point I was making was that we absolutely recognise that within the judicial system, you have to have an independent judiciary. You need safeguards to make sure that the police can carry out their work independently, and that all of those players need to play their roles independently, but need to come together to manage the system. The sorts of things that Mark's described in the example of the Aberdeen sheriffdom, with people getting together to manage the courts better, is a good example of people managing the business in ways that don't compromise that independence of their operation and decision making. I think we feel there may be scope for combining cases in the way that you're hinting at within the report, but that's one example of being much clearer about where people can work closely together to improve the working of the system and where they absolutely do need to operate independently.
And just finally, I was rather tantalised on page 37 by paragraph 65, which estimated 20 to 25 million could be saved each year by operating a fully digitalised justice system. So some years ago, wasn't there an attempt to put in place some sort of digital solution, and didn't that get at least partially scrapped? Am I memory right on that?
We like tantalising MSPs, so I'm glad that was helpful. Mark, would you like to respond to the question?
I think, and I may have to rely on Angela here rather more, but I think that you may be referring to an IT project that existed within the Crown Office, which we reported on a number of years ago. Angela, I don't know if you can...
Yes, Mark's right. I think you're referring to the ICT project that we reported on in 2012 in the Crown Office. Since then, the Justice Board was set up in 2011, and one of the things that it's done, all those senior people in the justice sector, they have developed the Justice Digital Strategy, which was published in 2014. That's setting out how they're all going to work together as part of the Making Justice work, and IT across the sector is one of the solutions that they're looking to. And on page 37, we identify a range of initiatives that are ongoing. Bringing Wi-Fi into courts is one of those things, making sure that there's video conferencing links within prisons so that prisoners can speak to their lawyers. So there's a lot going on, and the government has estimated that that improving the digital world and the justice system could make savings of 20 to 25 million.
Okay. Nigel
Dunn.
Thank you very much. Bina,
and good morning, Auditor General and colleagues. I'd like to concentrate on Exhibit 10 on page 27 and then just unpack a graph. It seems to me that there are four different spaces within this graph. If I can start with the very top left, the courts that had very small number of cases, understandably that may not appear to be terribly efficient. I'm proposing to discount that, having said it. The bottom left-hand corner represents a very large packed area of people who seem to work reasonably efficiently. By definition, some will, of course, be above average, or it wouldn't be an average. The two spaces which are interesting seem to me to be how you compare Paisley with the likes of Falkirk, and you might have put Dundee and Kilmarnock in that comparison, and then the top right-hand corner, which I'll come back to. Now, I notice if I turn over, and I did, that Paisley is actually looked at in case study three. But I'm not sure that I've seen in there where you feel the answer is. I think it's just a wider description of what you've observed. And I'm wondering, back in the days when I had a different kind of salary, I would have been dispatched if I'd had two factories that were that different in their efficiencies by the appropriate director to go and work out why. Surely somewhere, somebody is having a look at why.
You're absolutely right, Mr. Don. In my opening remarks, I said as well as there being marked variations between the six sheriffdoms, there are also marked variations within each sheriffdom, and you've put your finger on an example of that. Case study three talks through what the team found when they went out and looked at Paisley and Kilmarnock, two within the North Strathclyde sheriffdom. And I think the answer is, first of all, that there are no simple answers, and we recognise that that's the case. These are complex systems with an awful lot of factors going on. And secondly, that there are some things that we know from our audit work and that we've learnt from looking at places that are doing it well do make a difference. I'll perhaps ask Mark to talk you through the detail of that a bit further, and then we can come back on what the response is to the report.
I think what we heard in doing the field work was quite a lot of emphasis on the impact that culture and behaviour of all the individuals who are involved in the sheriff court system can have on overall performance. And we make reference to the culture of the defence in their attitude and their approach to, for example, not guilty pleas, the behaviour of accused and so forth. And that was emphasised again and again in terms of people sort of saying that's a really key factor associated with the performance of in this case, Paisley Sheriff Court. The reason we included that case study was it was within a single sheriffdom, and we tried to get as close as possible in terms of the volume of business, the distribution of crime types insofar as we could, but noted that there was that kind of very, very sharp difference in the performance of the two. But as I say, one of the things we heard during the fieldwork was very much an emphasis on the culture of defence agents and accused associated with Paisley.
Right, let's not try and get too parochial about it. Would it be fair to suggest that the sheriff principal has some responsibility for changing what happens there? Or who's responsible for this, please?
Sheriff's principal are responsible for kind of the management of court business within their sheriffdom, with sheriffs being kind of responsible for the management of individual courts and the effective sort of discharge of business through that.
So does the sheriff or the sheriff principal have the power to tell defence lawyers, if those are the people who are making the difference, that they should proceed differently?
I guess that's an ongoing discussion between sheriffs and the legal profession in terms of how they approach cases. I couldn't point you towards any definite examples of where that was happening and things, and that might be a question you might want to ask of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service.
I think it's also fair to say that power is probably a less useful word than influence. If you look again at the case study four on Aberdeen Sheriff Court, what happens there is that the sheriffs meet together to discuss their professional practice and make sure they're consistent. And what that does is discourage the defence agents from asking for adjournment on the basis they might get somebody else a second time. Now, that's one example, but it's the sort of thing that is within the power, the responsibility of the sheriffs and the sheriff principals. And I think it comes back to the need for, at a local level, people to understand the challenges they're facing and to think through what are the actions that will make a difference in that particular set of circumstances.
Yes, okay. Well, without getting too personal, that may be where I should leave it, but I also recognise the influence of sheriff's clerks in that kind of environment, and particularly perhaps in Aberdeen. Could I just explore, convener, the situation in the top right-hand corner of Exhibit 10, then, where I find our two biggest cities? Clearly there's some kind of constraint in there. It can't be the inefficiency that comes from small numbers. It appears to be an inefficiency from large numbers, which you wouldn't have expected of itself. Does it come down to a lack of space, a lack of sheriffs, the interaction with all the other business that's going on? Or do we actually know what it comes down to, please?
Mark.
I think it's probably a combination of all those factors. There is a large volume of business. We've talked about the increasing sort of complexity of cases which are being heard, the competing demands, as we spoke to Mr. Beattie about, in terms of JP business and fatal accident inquiries occupying courtrooms and things. There are issues about scheduling. Different courts take very different approaches to the number of cases which are scheduled for a given day, and that seems to have an impact on how long it takes for cases to get through the system as a whole. And again, you made reference to the kind of the role of sheriff clerks in terms of management of business, and that is a key factor in how that happens. There is no simple answer. One of the recurrent themes in doing this bit of work was A, how complicated it was as a system, and B, that there was no one single driver that you could kind of easily pick on to try and untangle what causes the problems.
Could I just have one very, very quick follow-up then? I guess those in Edinburgh would argue they're just as efficient as Aberdeen, Inverness, so maybe I shouldn't pick on them and I won't. Is there somebody in the Glasgow system who actually feels responsible for what's going on there? Again, I don't want to be personal about it, but is it such a diffuse system that it's no one's responsibility?
I think one of the challenges that the system faces to manage itself as a system is, as the Auditor General has mentioned, is not everyone involved is seeking the same outcome. So the culture that defence agents and the accused adopt can actually have an impact on kind of how well the system performs as a whole. Also, you've got the necessary independence of the judiciary, of the police, of Procurator Fiscal Service in terms of making their decisions. But at the same time, they all have to operate together. So in terms of, is there one person who's responsible for all of that? No, I don't think there is. I think it is a very large and, as you say, slightly diffuse system, but they are working better together, certainly at the national level, to try and make things flow through the system.
Good morning. There's two issues, just one a very slight issue, and the other one is a churn, which I want to raise. In your submission, you mentioned the fact there's limited information on the full cost of prosecuting criminal cases through the sheriff court system, and therefore you have to estimate the cost. Is this because it's not joined up thinking? Obviously, we're talking about data and previous witnesses. So how do you estimate a cost in regards to that, and why can't you get the full information?
The reason why it's difficult is because the costs sit in the budgets of the various organisations involved, at Police Scotland, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, all have parts of the budget for prosecution and all have budgets that cover other things as well. So estimating how much of it relates to this isn't as straightforward as you might think it was. Mark's team did a good job in coming up with a good estimate and using that to estimate the costs of things like churn, and I'll ask him to talk you through briefly how they did that.
What we did was, in collaboration with the various public bodies involved, we built estimates of how long an individual member's staff would spend on a particular component of the system. So whether it was preparing a prosecution report or marking a case or appearing as a witness. We then took salary data from each of the bodies involved and basically added it all up to come up with the overall estimate of 203 million. So rather than looking at it from the perspective of the budgets of the individual bodies, we tried to build it bottom up in terms of the activities that the individuals involved were actually kind of, I guess, costing in terms of their salary and time costs.
Thank you very much. It must have been a very long and laborious exercise. It was actually following on from Colin Beattie's question about the various levels of the court cases as well. The one I wanted to pick up on was the churn, and having been a member of the Justice Committee, and I know they're looking at that, we also looked at the churn, and having spent some time going visiting the courts, certainly as the convener had mentioned also, witnesses, police, that type of thing, defence lawyers putting in various what you might say challenging and then resulting in say not guilty, and then some cases lasting a year, year and a half. So obviously churn is a huge big issue in that respect. And I realise that the Aberdeen Sheriff Court system, it seems to be one that's working, and basically simply because, and you mentioned your report, they challenge requests for adjournments and encourage cases to be resolved early. So obviously they're challenging the defence lawyers. Now, this is Aberdeen Sheriff Court. Is that, would that be put through other courts as mandatory, or would that have to be just, we might take that up?
I think what we're recommending is that approach to sort of joint working rather than each sheriff simply managing the cases that come to his or her court on the day would make a difference. The difference it would make would differ in different parts of Scotland depending on the challenges they were facing. So Mr. Beattie talked about the likelihood of a different type of case. Actually, sorry, I think it was Mr. Don, different types of cases in Glasgow. You would need to understand what the makeup of cases was, the extent to which things like the attitude of defence agents was affecting that, and then together decide what the best approach was to dealing with it. But the key recommendation in the report, I think, is that that joint working has made a difference at the national level, and there's a real opportunity to get the same difference at a local level using this sort of analysis and the better information that we think is needed about cost, but not just about cost, about all of the other things that make up the system mm-hmm. as well.
Very good recommendation, but you also mentioned the fact individuals there, and defence lawyers, I presume, is part of the individuals in certain areas. Could I also ask you, I know the police were looking into weekend courts as a recommendation. Would that stop some of the churn if that was accepted, the weekend courts?
I'm not sure it would necessarily automatically stop churn, but it would certainly kind of generate more greater availability of time in terms of court days and things. But obviously that would come with increased costs in terms of a greater number of days. Those courts would have to be supported by all the bodies involved. Mm. So whether that would generate additional efficiencies in the truest sense, I think would perhaps be interesting to explore. But it may help in terms of addressing the performance against the 26-week measure mm. that all the criminal justice bodies have.
Well, certainly your recommendation or estimates is that churn is costing £10 million, so therefore against that and having weekend courts to alleviate the churn might actually save monies in the long run as well. If I could just pick in very briefly, I think it was Angela Cullen, sorry, that mentioned the fact about the new digital systems that were put in place, and obviously you went round and spoke to lawyers and courts, etc. Was there any answer that you were given in the fact that we were looking at a secure email system, and only one third of the defence lawyers had signed up to it? And another one was a video conferencing, which you mentioned, to be installed in every prison, and that was to, you know, alleviate churn as well. And yet only 40 solicitors, have less than 3%, have actually signed up to use that. Was there any answers you got about why the take-up in these two systems was so low?
The simple answer to that is no, we didn't have any evidence as to why there hadn't been that kind of a better uptake in those kinds of systems. So.
Okay, I'm fine.
Mary Scanlon.
Thank you.
I was looking at Exhibit 5 to look at to see if there had been a huge increase in presentations, as we'd call it, but the number of accused people in cases, and if I think you say it's been a variance of about 10% over the last 5 years. But to be honest, 2010-11 and 2014, there's actually been a reduction in the number of accused. So if at Sheriff Courts. I then go over to Exhibit 8, and if you look at this reduction in the number of people there, I find the figure of the percentage of summary cases concluded within 26 weeks. For example, I know the case across Scotland, there's a reduction of 8%, and it's not like A&E that we've got thousands more people, we've actually got fewer people. But for Glasgow and Strathkelvin, the percentage of summary cases in 2010-11 was 72, and it's now 52. So that area is getting significantly worse. And if I can take the other outlier that Nigel Dawn mentioned, Lothian and Borders, their figures have only reduced by 3%. So, you know, what I'm really asking is, with the same, or it would appear, fewer presentations over 5 years, the performance, and I know this isn't, my second question is about this as a measure on its own. I appreciate it's not a single measure of efficiency, but given the similar number of cases, the drastic fall by 20% is surely very concerning. Is there something behind that figure?
We think it's very clear that the sheriff court system is under real pressure. The two factors we draw out in the report are, first of all, the increasing complexity of cases and the growing proportion of cases that are either domestic violence or historic sexual crimes, and secondly, reducing budgets, and we think both of those are having an effect. You're right, we say that the 26-week measure isn't a good measure of efficiency on its own, but a number of other measures that we've looked at also show the same sort of pressure overall. And there are some sheriffdoms and some areas within sheriffdoms that are doing better than others. Those are the two sources of the pressure. What seems to make the difference is how well people are able to respond to them locally by understanding what's happening for them and then putting in place the measures that they can to influence and manage them.
Can I ask if there have been greater budget cuts in Glasgow as opposed to the other sheriffdoms that has led to this 20% fall? And secondly, has there been a greater number of complex domestic abuse, sexual abuse cases in Glasgow that would help us understand this figure?
I'll ask Mark to pick up the detail, if I may.
We haven't got the breakdown by sheriffdom in terms of kind of what the budgets were, and that would be a question that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service may be able to help with. In terms of the cases, again, we've reported at a national level. I don't to hand have the breakdown of case types by sheriffdom. It's also important to note that domestic abuse is not identified as a separate crime type. What we had to do was we had to identify all the cases which were effectively associated with a domestic abuse aggravator, is the technical term, which could span a range of the seven crime types that we highlighted in Exhibit 6. So I couldn't answer your question immediately in terms of disentangling the data as to whether in Glasgow and Strathkelvin there'd been any variation in terms of budgetary pressure or the crime type pressure.
Do you understand why in Edinburgh the reduction is 3%, in Glasgow it's 20 at quite incredible. My second question, convener, is I was quite surprised in the key messages on page 5, and knowing how precise Audit Scotland always is, the key messages, paragraph 2, we estimate Police Scotland, COPS, FS, etc., spent at least £203 million. Now, when you say at least, normally you're very precise. Do you not know how much they've spent? And if I could, I don't mean do you not know, do they not know is what I really meant. And just within that question, you also say that the 26 weeks for cases is not necessarily a measure of efficiency. So what is a measure of efficiency? Do we truly not know exactly how much money is spent? Because I've read quite a few of your reports, and putting in a figure at least is not normal Audit Scotland speak. So what was the figure? Do they know the figure? And what can be done to better understand how the money is spent, given that there's a 7% cut? And has this 7% cut led to the increases, for example, in Glasgow that I've just mentioned?
I'll kick off. The reason why we use the wording you've identified is that we can't be more precise than that, and neither can the bodies involved. As we said in response to an earlier question, the budgets are held by a number of bodies, Police Scotland, the Courts and Tribunal Service, the Crown Office, and they all do other things as well as prosecuting through the Sheriff Court. So as Mark described, we built a bottom-up model that comes up with our best estimate of it. We've discussed it with the bodies involved and use their starting data. I think we agree it's the best figure that's there, and it's not a precise cost. We would like to see the bodies working together to really understand both their costs and their activity better, and that should give better ways of managing it and also better public reporting of performance. Mark, I'll ask you to pick up the question about what information is needed to manage this better and where it's going.
In terms of your second question about kind of the measure of efficiency, what we have is the 26-week measure, which gives an important indication of performance in terms of the overall time taken from charge to verdict. But that's not related in any way to any form of input. That's purely an output. So as the Auditor General said, what we're recommending is that there's a better understanding of the activity costs, the unit costs associated with, for example, different types of case, different types of crime, and so on and so forth, so that those inputs can be related to the overall output in terms of performance. And we're keen that the Scottish Government and the other justice bodies look at our recommendation, explore how best to do that.
Just have you had a response to say that they will be working with you and responding to your recommendations and trying to get a better understanding?
I've already been in discussion with the court service and the government on that. So, okay.
Can I, on behalf of the committee, thank the General and the team for the contribution? And can I now, as agreed, move it to agenda item number 5, which you've agreed to do in private?